rolling.
One, two, one, two, three, four. A friendship forged in music, a partnership in its fourth decade, a lifetime in pursuit of the perfect song, and a community built along the way. 14 studio albums and another one in the wings. The band is Skydiggers. This is Employee of the Myth. Track 6, Come to My Senses.
It was the Quinn Martin production.
The Quinn Martin
production. 70s cop show kind of vibe.
And now, in conversation with Jane Gowan of the Music Buddy podcast, Andy Maize and Josh Finlayson, Skydiggers.
Here we are. We've come to our senses. We're at the sixth track of Hide Your Light. This whole album is so filled with soul and groove, and this is just another example of that. Andy, your intimate vocal that comes right in off the top. It's as if you're singing right into the camera. It's sort of almost telling us a secret. At that point, you're already invested because you want to hear what more you have to say. And I'm just thinking about that first line, which is, patiently I wait for your decision, even though I know it's time to leave. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, I don't really know what that's about, but
me
I'm
going to
groove anyway. And so how important is that first line? And do we really have to know what the song's about anyway?
I'm not really sure. You know, there are three verses to this song, and each one is, I don't know whether they're connected or whether they're all separate thoughts. I've never really been able to figure out what it's about, or I like the way the words flow together. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, I'm not really sure.
Okay.
And you know, this is a song that we wrote over 20 years ago.
Oh, really?
And that we demoed, and that never made it onto a recording, but then we started fooling around with it again before going out to BC to record. And Josh would just play the bass line. Mm-hmm. And I just started singing to the bass line. And that's how we actually did the it's not resung, it's just one time.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah. And that's the way we played it.
Oh, and then Joby added drums.
Yeah.
And B3 and maybe Whirly, I think. And that's,
yeah. Yeah.
And
there's definitely Whirly there. Daniel, or maybe even
Daniel,
maybe a Rhodes.
Trumpet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then Daniel came in and did his thing.
Did that growl and wail. I love how it goes from a contrast from that kind of sultry whirly bass vibe to the abandon of Daniel's trumpet, and just as if you're kind of waltzing off into the sunset almost. And
I play a little trumpet at the end. That ba ba ba.
You played ba, ba, some trumpet.
Ba, ba, yeah.
Oh, good. I'm glad you got your trumpet
I did
skills
get,
in there.
I mean,
they deserve to be heard.
Well, it was hard to take out of the case when Daniel's in the studio. It's a little bit intimidating.
Yeah. He has a very sweet sound.
Oh my God, he's
sure.
A beautiful, beautiful player.
I think knowing that Daniel was going to come and record with us, I think that set the table for us to make decisions. And he's super quick, and he and Joby have known each other for a long time. So mm-hmm. it was all very quick.
But this song is all built around your bass part. It really is. Everything, mm-hmm. everything kind of relates to the bass. And on several songs that we recorded, Joby also played congas,
mm-hmm.
and so you can hear there are congas on this song as well, in addition to his playing the kit. So that was kind of a new thing for us as well. I mean, there are congas on My City Is Gone. So it was interesting to have that kind of.
It was the Quinn Martin production.
The Quinn Martin for
the 70s cop show kind of vibe.
Well, it fits right in. I mean, it's, you know, congas sometimes have a certain connotation, but the way you've put them in there just fits right into the mm-hmm. style of your mm-hmm. music. It seems like there's a lot of sort of changing direction in this song. And you talk a lot about that in the album as well. And also your career has changed direction several times over mm-hmm. the years. And you've been forced to sometimes change direction. And it's almost like you've come to your senses and you're just so happy about that. And there's a certain element of finally finding out the truth, and the truth will set you free. Were you thinking a lot about that?
Yeah. Or maybe just a certain degree of maturity kicks in at some point in time where you say, you know, the stuff that you used to fixate about or be concerned about, you know, a friend once said to me, there, you know, there's life and death, and there's everything else. And so, you know, because I've had a tendency to sweat the small stuff. And I think ultimately, even though I say I don't know what this song is about, I think it's about moving forward mm-hmm. and not getting stuck on things that one has no control over.
And I've heard you say in the past, Josh, you know, if you end up having a singular vision, you're just going to sort of self-destruct, because you need to be able to absorb things from other ideas and move forward that way creatively, right?
I mean, I think any creative endeavor has to evolve and change. I mean, otherwise it's, what is it? It's static. It's, mm-hmm. and which is fine. If that's what you're after, then there's nothing wrong with that. But if you're, but I think, yeah, evolution is imperative if you're creating.
And do you think with this album that you have moved another step forward? And do you feel like you felt like you had artistic freedom and you embraced that?
Yes.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't think we can underestimate Joby's influence on all this, and Daniel's. But mm-hmm. I mean, we were also open to it. I mean, we've been doing this a long time, and I think there would have been a time in our recording career, you know, and our time of making records where we would have resisted. We would have said, no, that's not what we do, or that's not who we are. But I think I think in a lot of ways, Desmond's was a bit of a departure for us, because we had no choice. It was different. And I think since, and you know, Andy's mentioned this, you know, this is, it's not like Desmond's Hip City, but it's maybe, in the sense that it is quite a different record mm-hmm. for us. It's a bit of a departure from what we have done, or what mm-hmm. we would maybe gravitate towards mm-hmm. as a band. But I think that, again, I think Joby, I mean, that's why we went and worked with him, and he was an amazing producer and musician to work
collaborator.
With. Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally yeah. collaborator. Like yeah. he was, and I know he had, you know, we all had a lot of fun doing it. It was pretty much,
except
we would get
COVID.
A song or two. we would get a song or two done every day, mm-hmm. you know, almost entirely. Like it was, and he didn't work long days. You know, it was all very kind of civilized. He would make a meal in between the morning and the afternoon. But it's amazing how efficient it was, mm-hmm. and you know, thinking of other times where he made records where, I mean,
14-hour days.
Oh, yeah. And yeah, like just like, you know, after, again, 6 hours, you know, it's the point of diminishing returns.
Yeah.
It's definitely set in. But anyway, yeah.
You've got this great ability, both of you, to create these songs that are sometimes can be at once serious, but also very joyful and happy, like this one is. And, you know, even at the end, it sounds like, I might have said this before, but it sounds like you're skipping off into the future joyfully with abandon. But, you know, it's also addressing some more serious stuff on another level. And so you can still dance to it, mm-hmm. but it might also give you pause if you were to read the lyrics or something like that. Mm-hmm. And I think of a song like Warmth of the Sun that, I mean, until recently, I didn't realize what the subject matter of that song was. But your ability to have those contrasts in your song, I mean, maybe it doesn't matter what the song's about. Maybe it just matters that people are singing along. And what do you think?
I mean, I think people ultimately choose what resonates with a song. It's like looking at a painting, you know. I look at a painting, you look at it, something resonates in that to me, to you, it does a nothing, you know. Like it's just people get out of any kind of art something or they don't. It's and that's okay. Ideally you get a reaction, even if it's a negative reaction, at least it's a reaction. Mm-hmm. We can't control that. You can just control what you make and what we put out there.
Do you feel that by being, I mean, would you call yourselves an independent band? Or
I would say so at this point, yeah.
Yeah. And do you feel that by being that, you've got more freedom? And would you be writing a record like this if you were on a larger label, do you think? Or
oh, probably.
Yeah. I mean, I mean, with the exception of being signed to Warner for one record, I would say we pretty much did what we wanted on that record. We had a lot of material we recorded.
Yeah. And that was what record again?
Road Radio.
Road Radio.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But we, you know, I mean,
we've always had
artistic freedom.
Yeah, we haven't had, other than when we did the first record, Derek Ross, who signed us to Enigma Records, asked us to speed up I Will Give You Everything a little bit and add another chorus at the end, which we thought was quite meddling that he would ask us to do that. And we were at first very reluctant to have the record company suggest any changes to our music. Mm-hmm. And my God, he was right.
Yeah.
He was right. Never know the next time that you leave, I think I'd follow you. You know,
and you had a good working relationship with him, didn't you?
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, and still have a good relationship with him. You know,
yeah. Like he's, the single version is different than the album version. Michael Phillip came in and did a mix of the single and sped it up slightly, and we added a chorus at the end. And
but isn't it part of being young and that bravado that you have?
Yeah, we know everything.
20s, think.
We know everything.
We know everything, yeah.
And then you reach an age where you realize you know nothing.
And here we are. Well, I think this album, it sounds so new, but it sounds so timeless. So I think you've really accomplished
something. Well, what a compliment that is. Thank you, Jay.
Thank you, Jay.
Well, at this point, I just want to say thanks to Andy and Josh. It's such a pleasure to get to sit in the studio with them and listen to them play these wonderful new songs live. So here's Come to My Senses.
Patiently I wait for your decision. Even though I know it's time to leave, you think that this time that you can change your mind. There's no way back, no changing direction. Gracefully a brace for the collision. Head between my knees, a long way from home. You think that this time that I have lost my mind. Well, you're dead wrong. I've just come to my senses. Oh.
with this new album, do you feel like there are things that you've learned about yourselves along the way that have resulted in the songs on this album? Do you feel like you've come a long way? Do you feel like it was just that 1990 was just yesterday? Or what's the one of the biggest, I guess, takeaways for you?
It is one of those funny things where it feels like a lot of time has passed, but it also, 1990 does feel like it feels a long way away, but it also, it's present because we, you know, each night when we go out and we perform, we touch back on all the different times of our career. So we're constantly revisiting those times. And even though I think over time, the meaning of songs can change, even for us as we perform them, I think you also are always tapping into something each time you perform a song that was relevant. You have to tap into something to make the song relevant to you, not only from that time, but from who you are now. So there's this kind of weird collision of feelings, and but it all combines to make it hopefully authentic. That's why we can sing songs that are 32, 33 years old, because there's something that we can tap into those.
And you haven't strayed from being yourselves, obviously. Like, you've just
And you know, when we started the group, you know, our ambition was to write timeless songs that would not be identifiable in any particular era, and to record them in that way as well. I mean, there have been times where maybe there's a little too much snare drum in the from that time period in the sound, but I think that our goal was always to hopefully write and record songs that people could listen to and not necessarily be able to say, that's so 1995 or, you know.
And ideally also play songs that we could play like this, you know, like that. That was a lesson going into the band, because we had both played in bands where it had to be kind of a full, you know, it had to be the whole band, you know, and to have a guitar and two vocals and to be able to go anywhere, and it was liberating. And
so you can,
it still is ultimately, you know, like it's sort of a, you know, and there's so many songs and covers and things that we've learned and continue, and like the Ronnie Lane song as an example, it's just another sort of touchstone of it. It's a timeless song, and I think that's part of what resonates for us, and that's always, I mean, I think you continue learning, but hopefully we also continue trying to pursue for whatever we think is authentic and genuine to ourselves, if that's a pursuit you can achieve.
I think it's good, and I think it's great that you've got each other to keep each other on track and in check and keep each other amused.
Absolutely.
And laughing.
So we didn't get together from March of 2020 until June of 2020.
Oh, really?
And then
did you send letters to each other?
On an afternoon in June of 2020, when the weather was lovely, we got together in Josh's backyard and we played for the first time in what felt like years.
Oh, amazing.
And we were both so excited that we got drunk at the end of our playing together for the first time in about 4 months. But I think we both at that point realized how much we missed doing this. Even if it's not for anybody but ourselves, at the end it's the friendship, and we are the instrument, and we'll always have a friend as long as we have this instrument.
As we speak of music with adult themes wrapped in infectious melodies, here are Josh and Andy with the title track of their 9th album, A Plea for Compassion and Healing. Here's Warmth of the Sun, live from the woodshed.
All I can say here is let's make this right. When you bury the past, it'll haunt you at night. Promises made, meant to be kept, to honor your word, means to never forget.
It's been a long time coming, such a long time coming now.
Warmth up the sun, heal everyone. Let the stars and the moon reveal the truth.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Andy. Thank you, Josh.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you, Jane.
Thank you, Joel and Tim.
Thank you, Joel. Yeah. Thank you, Tim.
The album is called Hide Your Light. The band is Skydiggers. And this has been Employee of the Myth. Employee of the Myth is hosted by Jane Gowan and recorded at Blue Rodeo's Woodshed Studios in Toronto, Ontario.
The podcast is engineered by Tim Vesely and mixed by Jane Gowan.
If you enjoyed this conversation, please rate, review, share, subscribe, and play it loud. My name is Joel Stewart. Thanks for listening.
Don't look to me for the answer. I don't know nothing anymore. I'll do my best in the meantime. And wonder what it's been for. Je t'aime toujours, mon amour. Je t'aime toujours, mon amour.